Broadside Books and Harper Audio present Shepherds for Sale: How Evangelical Leaders Traded the Truth for a Leftist Agenda by Megan Basham. This is the author. For my father, who taught me to stand alone when it means standing on the truth, and for Brighton and Shelby, who I hope to teach the same. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Matthew 15:9. Presenting an issue sharply is indeed by no means a popular business at the present time. There are many who prefer to fight their intellectual battles in what has been aptly called a condition of low visibility. Clear-cut definition of terms in religious matters, bold facing of the logical implications of religious views, is by many persons regarded as an impious proceeding. But with such persons, we cannot possibly bring ourselves to agree. Light may seem at times to be an impertinent intruder, but it is always beneficial in the end. The type of religion which rejoices in the pious sound of traditional phrases, regardless of their meanings, or shrinks from controversial matters, will never stand amid the shocks of life. In the sphere of religion, as in other spheres, the things about which men are agreed are apt to be the things which are least worth holding. The really important things are the things about which men will fight. J. Gresham Machen, Christianity and Liberalism, 1923. Introduction. How do you solve a problem like the Christians? Even in church, we worry about world problems we cannot understand or master, and we waste our time and substance on committees whose announced purpose is to save the world and whose real purpose turns out to be getting some politician elected. Even in church, we are so shaky in our faith in the next world that we often talk as if the teachings and promises of our Lord were a mere convenience for putting this world to rights. Well, but mustn't the churches adapt Christianity to suit the ideas of our time? No, they must not. Our ideas are killing us spiritually. When your child swallows poison, you don't sit around thinking of ways to adapt his constitution to a poisonous diet. You give him an emetic. Joy Davidman, a.k.a. Mrs. C.S. Lewis. When a group of friends from church invited Bailey Anderson to put on a pink knitted hat and join them at the 2017 Women's March, she assumed her confusion was a matter of geography. She and her husband James didn't just live in California, they lived in deep blue Los Angeles, where James worked as a software engineer for a major film studio. They'd relocated to America's second largest city 5 years before, from a rural town an hour outside of Atlanta where they hadn't been able to walk to the grocery store, but also hadn't encountered heroin addicts shooting up on the sidewalk on Sunday afternoons. Finding a good church quickly became one of their first priorities. We were this young evangelical couple with a 14-month-old toddler and a baby on the way. We knew we needed community if we were going to survive, Bailey told me with a chuckle, only half joking. In Georgia, they'd attended a contemporary non-denominational church, so they looked for similar options in L.A., and they took the quest seriously, averaging 2 services in 2 different congregations every Sunday morning. On Saturday nights, we did this whole complicated thing of looking at different churches on a map and plotting out service times and distance, trying to figure out if we went to a 9 a.m. service at one location, if we could make it to a 10:30 a.m. service at another, James recalled. They also did their homework, researching pastoral blogs and online statements of faith, eliminating options that didn't seem doctrinally sound. Once they were sitting in a pew, or more often a row of padded chairs, they paid close attention to the sermons, asked questions during the pastor meet and greets, and spent several weeks attending likely candidates. They didn't view themselves as especially partisan, but they also didn't view issues like abortion and the definition of marriage as political. These were matters of spiritual conviction, and they knew that whatever church they settled in, it had to have biblical positions on sexuality and the sanctity of life, even if those subjects were rarely addressed from the pulpit. It wasn't as easy as you might think, said James. You kind of had to listen for the buzzwords and know how to interpret them. Like if the pastor talked about how Jesus came to fix our brokenness, you knew that probably meant sin. And that was especially true if he applied brokenness to sexuality. You knew what he meant, but wasn't willing to outright say. It took a few months, some trial and error, and a couple of extended false starts, but eventually they settled into a church that, if a little lacking in theological depth, still felt like a place where they could grow among like-minded believers. Now, as she sat before the LED glare of her laptop screen, scrolling through the search returns for Women's March and Pussycat Hat, Bailey felt disoriented. Climate change, LGBTQ rights, workers' rights, immigration reform, racial justice, abortion, abortion, abortion. She had some sympathy for one or two of the grab bag of issues this march was supposed to represent, but she couldn't understand why Christians would want to take part in an event almost entirely opposed to a holistic understanding of biblical ethics. "I was so naive at the time," she told me in a soft Southern drawl. "I didn't even know what the hat meant, that it was supposed to represent female genitalia." More than disoriented, she was discouraged. Even in LA, church was supposed to be the one place her family could find fellowship with other committed Christians. The couple wrote the experience off as a locational hazard. "We just assumed it was California," James said. "What are you going to do?" When they moved back home to Georgia a year later, they thought things would be different. Safely ensconced back in the Bible Belt, they figured they'd plug right back into the megachurch they'd left. But it, too, had changed. The pastor had always embraced a seeker-sensitive model, meaning the worship style, pop and rock, and sermon focus, practical life improvement, were designed to be as inoffensive and culturally familiar to non-Christian visitors as possible. But in the intervening years, sensitivity had tipped over into the doctrinally dubious. One weekend, the pastor preached a sermon in which he suggested that some of the Bible's moral standards were no longer applicable to modern society. He was cagey about what he meant, but he would later imply it's unloving for believers to define homosexuality and transgenderism as sins. By then it was 2019, and some church staffers invited James to join a racial reconciliation study group titled Be the Bridge. Once there, he was told that new white members weren't allowed to speak for the first 6 months. They were only to do the work of listening and completing a whiteness 101 reading list. James abided by those rules for a few weeks, keeping notes on his now glaring concerns. Even more than the division this particular curriculum seemed sure to stoke, he was alarmed at how the instructors were applying it to broader areas of life. "I started noticing that a lot of the discussion centered not just on racial justice, but on quite a lot of leftist causes. The women who led the group would frequently talk about oppressed-oppressor dynamics. At one point, they told us we needed to read more books from queer authors because they were an oppressed group too. And that's when it really started to click for me that this was a slippery slope to all sorts of dynamics." James never made it through the probationary period. When another white member who had managed to stay mute for 6 months got sent back to a three-month talking timeout for politely challenging the moderator's claims regarding police shooting data, James left the group. The straw that broke the camel's back came one Sunday when the worship pastor told the congregation that God went looking for Adam and Eve after they ate the apple because he wanted to tell them, "There's nothing you could do to ever separate you from my love." "I just turned to Bailey and said, 'I can't do this anymore,'" James remembered. "It was straight heresy. If sin doesn't separate you from God, then what are we doing?" We were just so hungry for real teaching at that point. Their next stop was a Presbyterian Church of America, PCA Church. Though they are Reformed Baptists by conviction, they were happy to agree to disagree on secondary doctrines so long as the preaching was sound. A few weeks in, the pastor began a series on justice, by which he meant solely racial justice. The final sermon, the last Sunday the Andersons attended, was on generational sins. At the end, the pastor asked all of the white people in the service to stand up and applaud for the black people, to let them know they were personally repenting of America's history of racism and systemic injustice. "It was a really awkward moment," James said. Just a few minutes before, you were smiling and chatting with the African-American next to you, and then suddenly you're being put through this kind of struggle session. And even though you're not good with what's happening, you don't want to stay seated and have people go, "Oh, there's a racist right there." So we stood. It especially grated on Bailey to hear these pastors make the broad brush claim that white families had accumulated wealth and advantages at the expense of black suffering. She had grown up in an abusive home to an alcoholic mother who eventually abandoned her and her three younger brothers. Her father was semi-present, but his failure at a string of blue-collar businesses like lawn care and carpentry had left the family living paycheck to paycheck, and there was a parade of women in and out of the house. At 16, Bailey found herself stepping into the role of parent to her siblings, making their meals, driving them to school. Through it all, the church had been her sanctuary. She first heard the gospel as a young child at Awana. She came to saving faith at 17 in her high school's youth group. Yet now, as an adult, she could not find that same haven away from the turmoil and conflict of the world, where the unchanging wisdom of the word, rather than trendy social issues, would be preached. "I think that was when it really hit us. This is a bigger problem," she said. "This is not just California craziness. It's not a red state or a blue state thing. This is something in the church." I have talked with dozens of Jameses and Baileys over the last few years, people who have reached out to me due to my reporting on the evangelical world. They are ordinary Christians who feel confused and dismayed to see well-known pastors and ministry leaders letting the culture rather than scripture dictate the content of their teaching. They see leaders insisting that Jesus requires them to get COVID-19 vaccinations and lobby for immigration bills, but doesn't require them to speak clearly about sexual morality. They feel, frankly, like sheep without shepherds. What they all want to know: what is going on? Why is this happening everywhere? Infiltrating the Last Fortress. A couple of years ago, my husband and I took an anniversary trip to Boston and visited the King's Chapel. As our guide explained, the King's part of that moniker is noteworthy. The Lord Bishop of London established America's first Church of England congregation in 1686, in part to shore up the crown's authority over belligerent Puritan colonists who had a penchant for defying English law. Today, the media and publishing industries insist that the political right is playing the role of King James, leveraging churches to fulfill political aims. The last few years have seen a barrage of high-profile authors and filmmakers proclaiming that something sinister has driven the evangelical preference for conservative candidates for decades. Every major news outlet from CBS to the BBC faded Jesus and John Wayne, a book that claims even Billy Graham was motivated more by politics than faith, wedding patriarchal gender roles to a rising Christian nationalism. Tim Alberta similarly celebrated the kingdom, the power, and the glory, argues that American church leaders of the late 20th century opposed pornography, homosexuality, drug use, rising divorce rates, secularism in public schools, and above all, abortion, not because the Bible speaks to these topics, but because these leaders needed an issue set that would satisfy the lowest common denominator of their socially conservative constituency. You have to wonder what nefarious political powers Alberta thinks were at work in the first century church that caused it to likewise prioritize sobriety, marriage, sexual purity, and protecting the innocent. The narrative that the GOP has dangerously co-opted the American church is built almost entirely on speculation, subjective stories, and the fact that evangelicals voted for Donald Trump at about the same rate as they voted for previous Republican presidential candidates. But it serves a dual purpose. If churchgoers can be convinced there's something shameful and unchristian in bringing their values to the democratic process, first, it will blunt their influence on the culture. Second, they will be distracted from noticing the secular left's long and well-documented history of infiltrating churches and buying influence among church leaders, a history that still marches on today. In his book, The Devil and Karl Marx, political science professor Paul Kanger describes the process the Communist Party USA used between 1920 and 1950 to deliberately infiltrate mainline Protestant churches and woo pastors to their socialist program. I found repeatedly, dating back a century, beginning with the launch of the Soviet Comintern, and
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.